Hi, everyone. Welcome to the panel. Our panel is called Moving Beyond the MOOCs, the Future of Corporate Learning and Technology. My name is Saurabh Sungvi, and I'm a partner with McKinsey & Company, and I do all of my work in workforce development, education technology, and corporate learning. And today, before we get started, we wanted to do a quick poll so that we can better talk to the audience. And so with a quick raise of hands, I'd love to hear, who are the entrepreneurs in the room? Okay, we'll call that a solid majority. Who are the investors in the room? Who isn't in any one of those categories? Okay, hopefully everybody felt included in that quick poll. Thank you very much. So today what we're gonna do is we're gonna get into three major themes. The first theme that we're gonna get into is the question that I always get, which is, what is the winning business model in corporate learning? And how do we really think about reaching scale in workforce development? The second topic that we're gonna get into is, how do we truly reach everyone? What is it gonna take to reach all individuals and truly increase the economic mobility and upward mobility of everyone? And then finally, if we have enough time, we're gonna get into some bold predictions about what's coming next. And we'll have the panelists look into their crystal ball, and we'll have some things that we can have some fun and bet on. And so without further ado, let me introduce my panelists. I'll let them actually introduce themselves. And so Ardeen, do you wanna start?
Ardeen Williams, I lead workforce development for Amazon, that little company up in Seattle and in Arlington, Virginia.
And Ardeen, just to break the ice, do you mind telling everybody why you enjoy your job?
I enjoy my job because I have the opportunity to help create pathways to career mobility for 1.3 million people.
Thanks for obliging to that. Darren, do you want to go next?
Yep. At the other end of the scale of 1.3 million people, my name is Darren Chimkus. I'm CEO of Modal. We're a self-stage, very early stage startup focused on employee skills improvement, particularly in and around tech. Been doing this for years, the bulk of my career. Before this, I built Udemy's B2B practice. And I would say, in response to the question of why do I love this industry, you know, I've seen a lot of different industries, and I've seen nothing that can improve people's lives the way that when we're doing our jobs right, that ours can.
TJ, do you want to try to follow that one?
I think I can. So TJ Williams, I'm the Chief Revenue Officer of Degreed. I'm based in Austin, Texas. We were just talking about how much that city has grown in the last couple years. To answer the question, I would say when you're a chief revenue officer, you care about money. And if you think about when people can upskill themselves with your technology that you're able to put out into the world, they're typically gonna learn a lot of new things and they're gonna make more money. So is where I care a lot about making money for our organization. I like to think that a lot of people can make a lot more money for themselves and better than their families.
That's great. And Pierre, do you want to round us out?
Sure. So Pierre Debac, I'm one of the two co-founders and the CEO of Open Classrooms. We're an online education platform, a B Corp certified company, making education more accessible and training on fully online degree programs leading to new careers, mostly in tech and digital jobs. And why do I like my job? I actually started my job long, long time ago in middle school. We're 11 and 13, so it's been like 20 years I've been doing that. And I enjoy it mostly because of the impact we have on people's lives, and we track it through the number of students we place in the workforce, and that's really what matters for us at the end of the day.
Great. Well, so let's jump in. And so the first theme that I talked about was, let's talk about, what does it take to win in corporate learning, and what does it take to scale? And just to frame this, I think what's really exciting about right now is we're truly at a moment. You know, if you think about it, funding is at record highs. Job openings are at record highs. There's new companies entering the space, everyone from the tech giants to brand new startups that I just learned about today. At the same time, we've done a lot of research, and the need for upskilling and reskilling is greater than ever. And if you talk to any CEO, if you talk to any governor, workforce development, upskilling, reskilling, hiring, talent retainment is the top of everyone's agenda. And so in that world and in that moment, you know, what will it take to win? And so maybe to get us started, Darren, I'd love your thoughts on what are winning business models and what does it take to win in this space?
So first I'll start off targeted a little bit about at some of the, maybe the entrepreneurs, Series A, early stage companies who are trying to either break into the B2B market or scale the B2B market. I want to talk about the people making the decisions for many of these enterprise learning products. Because to me, the question of what's the best business model really depends on who are these people. And so when you dig into whether it's the HR department, learning development department, or even technical enablement teams, when you dig into a little bit of the psyche, much like a lot of startups, people who are running those groups are very much test and learn type people. So where I've seen the most success is not necessarily going in and saying, you know what, I have something that's gonna solve all of your problems for your entire company, it's gonna be $5 million, it's gonna be great. I've seen much more success with the start small and grow from there approach, and it really does work. And so starting with a group of 500 people, depending on what your product is, scaling to 5,000, scaling to 50,000, what you're doing is you're demonstrating to the customer that you understand them and your product meets their needs, but you're also not pushing them a little further than where they need to go. And so the final thing I would say in all this is, as much as we're all building learning products and learning experiences, probably the single biggest differentiator that allows you to do that is investing in customer success, customer partners, to help make each one of those engagements, each one of those relationships really, really sing.
TJ, do you want to highlight where you'd agree, but more importantly, where you might disagree with that?
Sure. So we have a little bit different go-to-market than Darren described as kind of like the dream go-to-market where you can land and expand. We actually try to go enterprise-wide early into our engagements with most of the companies that we try to sell into. I would add, though, if we could do something kind of different, go back in time, it'd be nice if we could have a model where we built a product from the beginning that fit both the needs of the mid-market and the enterprise. So we really went after the enterprise. And sometimes, you know, companies go after mid-market, or they go after SMB first, and they try to move up to the larger organizations, and sometimes they do the opposite. But if I could kind of build the perfect company from scratch, I would say try to build a business model that kind of goes after both, because it's nice to have, you know, different revenue streams coming in from different size organizations versus having to depend on just like the giant whale of an account or just all the small numbers from the SMBs. So I would try to do both.
And Pierre, maybe let me get you into this conversation. So you, in many ways, have started in a different geography. How have you started to think about expanding globally? And in particular, you also could go after consumers, you could go after the enterprise segment. Have you thought about what's your sweet spot and what's a winnable model?
Yeah, so we actually started in B2C in Europe. And when we started expanding in other geographies, we figured actually B2C is a much more regulated space in which you might need licenses, you might need accreditation, access to public funding. So it's a more complex go-to-market. So we actually prefer to go the B2B route, and we started more enterprise in upskilling and reskilling. And then we moved into the apprenticeship world, which is more of a recruitment piece, talking to a different group of people, meaning upskilling and reskilling would be more L&D functions, whereas apprenticeship would be more recruitment functions and directly business leaders. And that went into the SMB segments. So we started really enterprise, then went into the SMB segments, but clearly it really depends on the market and the geographies as well. We've seen very different approaches depending on the competition, but also on the regulatory environment. I think this is an important piece, actually.
And let me build on that, and I'll, anybody who wants to answer this one. So one of the tough parts about this market is there's so many different ways to approach it, whether you think about industries, whether you think about size of company. And when you look at most companies that are playing in this space, there are very few, for example, if we just use $1 billion in revenue of companies that have reached that number. And so I'd be curious, as you all think about different strategies, what's it gonna take to actually get to a company that can reach that scale?
I'll kick this off. I think it takes demonstrable learner outcomes at scale in a way that organizations can measure and appreciate. And I think we're on our way there. And I think it's been a path for this industry to really be able to both do both those things, deliver and measure. But once we do that, I think we'll be laughing at this idea of what is it going to take to create a billion-dollar revenue company. Because we think about the global economy, I mean, we win and lose as companies by the skills of our employee base. And so the more that we're able to demonstrably and predictably improve those skills, that's a huge, huge force multiplier for which any CFO and any company you're ever going to speak with will be willing to spend real money.
Anybody else want to add on?
I think I can add just a little bit to that. So, you know, I've only been in kind of the education space for 4 years. And I think when I first came, I was kind of blown away at how low some of the price points were with some of the offerings, just compared to products I'd sold in the past, mostly to CIO organizations. And so if you think about just the value that L&D products can bring a company, I think it really starts with a cultural shift that has to start within a company to get the CFO to give bigger budgets to their buyers. And so if you think about, you know, what we might have sold different products in my past for versus today, if you can get these price points up, then we'll see companies get to $1 billion. But I think if they stay super low and kind of commodity-based, it's going to be really hard for some companies to reach that type of scale.
Very true, and I think the L&D market is extremely large, but on products that are not very costly, around, you know, a few dollars, $10,000, maybe $200 a year, but it doesn't really create much value in most cases, or usage and engagement can be pretty low in those communities. And then we see many companies talking about upskilling and reskilling and the need that they need to reskill, let's say, 50,000 employees. But very few of those companies have dedicated significant budgets to that. Obviously, Amazon is one of them, but it's more of the exceptions on the market right now. So you need to really target the companies with significant budget when it comes to upskilling and reskilling. And there are just a few of them still at this stage. And then when you want to sell products with a higher price point, I'd say, obviously, you can think you might be able to rescale 10,000 people, but actually in reality, you're gonna probably start with a pilot with 50 people, 100 people, but with a much higher price point. So I think this is kind of a niche market that is still fairly small in terms of size, but that is really booming right now. So it could be interesting instead of going into the upscaling / L&D that is pretty crowded.
And let me go to Ardeen on this one. So Ardeen, you're of course at one of those companies that, you know, is spending a lot, but in very decentralized ways. And I'd love to hear a little bit about, you know, from an employer perspective, how would you respond to these things and share a little bit about what Amazon's doing?
So I think from this panel, you've heard a lot of the real critical points. Darren talked about the ability to start small and to scale. And I was listening to the example of, oh, it's 50 or 100 hour experiments. We don't move to pilot, we start with experiment. Start with about 15 people. And that's across an employee base of 1.3 million. And we experiment, we modify, and then we re-engineer, double down, and then scale the heck out of it. And the only way that we get the funding to continue to do that is to come to measurable outcomes. Am I, in fact, connecting people with jobs? So for middle-skill workers, am I moving them into jobs that pay at least 10% more than we do? So we have a $15 minimum wage. We, you know, with an average starting wage of $17 in the U.S., add benefits to that, and I'm now looking across the U.S. where there's a minimum wage of $7 and a quarter at upping that outcome by at least 10%. The next piece is the flexibility. And I think that this comment about, hey, it has to be, you know, TJ said, I want to be able to go after enterprise and I want to be able to go after small and medium-sized business. And I think that's key because while Amazon is, I think someone said a whale, it wasn't that way when I started, but it really is made up of a bunch of really disparate, scrappy businesses. And that means that you're dealing with Amazon Studios or PillPack or Amazon Web Services. And those are all very different business models within the company. And so there really isn't, I think it's tough to go into a company like an Amazon or a Google and say, hey, we have this one size fits all, because there's this compelling concern on our part that it needs to be flexible enough to accommodate the difference, and it needs to scale significantly. And so our inclination tends to be, well, you know, maybe what we should do is we'll look at ideas and do some experimenting, and then we'll build it ourselves.
Maybe sticking with you, Ardeen, when we've looked at, you know, just looking at spend that's going towards adult training, the thing that shocks me is that at the end of the day, and the numbers, you can argue with them, but approximately $100 billion is going towards, you know, private sector spend. $300 billion is actually coming from public spend. Now, as you think about the discussion that was even on the last panel and everything else that's happening in the White House, that number is getting even higher. And Amazon, in my opinion, has been doing a lot to innovate with a lot of public sector players. And so I'd love how you all are thinking about not just what Amazon does, but how do you creatively extend and take advantage of some of those public funds to scale everything that you're doing?
So we're very excited about the Department of Commerce effort that was announced, I think, last week from EAD, the $3 billion Build Back Better. And I think the interesting opportunity there is to think beyond a single company or a single institution. It really is about creating talent pipelines in a community. And it's about how we create that ecosystem. And that's why I'm excited about the EAD program, because what it's doing is connecting conveners. So how is it that you say, in an area like Austin, what are the talent pipelines that are needed? What are the knowledge, skills, and abilities? Who are the providers who can do that? How do you get agreement across a large number of providers and a large number of employers so that you can, in fact, upskill that workplace? And that's really, as we're thinking about it, what role can we help to play in helping understand that being a talent donator as a company is actually a good thing? And that's a real mind shift. I mean, you're talking about still trying to get CFOs to unleash more money, but then to think about training people to go to other companies is a little bit even further on the edge.
Anybody else on the panel want to talk about how you're thinking about trying to get more public funds?
Yeah, definitely. Back to this regulatory question that I mentioned earlier, in many countries, there is a different balance across the source of funding, individuals, employers, or governments. In Europe, it could be more heavier on the governments, in the US, more on the individuals, depending also on the age of your students. So here, it would be mostly through Title IV funding or, you know, some sort of tuition assistance funding. And obviously that really changes your model, because when you have to get degree accreditation, for example, it will have a very deep impact on your product. But we see more and more those platform models, like, you know, Coursera or even 2U, with the acquisition of edX, moving into a multiple funding source mechanism with B2C, B2B, and B2G. And it's likely that with those partnerships across, you know, private and public institutions, we'll see a huge need of edtech players to move into this flywheel approach, as they call it. But it gets more complex, so you need to have very different skill sets. So I would recommend trying to have a more focused approach at first and say, okay, I'm going to focus on B2B and enterprise and mid-market in this geography, and then add on top of that maybe B2G and selling to governments, as this is a really different skill set, again, involving lobbying efforts, public affairs, and bidding to RFPs and whatnot. So it's very complex to be successful across the board in the three different segments.
Well, I was just going to add that so many governments have made the barrier of entry so high for small software companies to sell their products into. It's really just a shame. I mean, just the amount of effort it takes to become FedRAMP certified and the cost, it really just puts so many software companies just outside kind of looking in. And so you kind of have to kind of wonder, are governments so behind in this skills gap because the technology that they have right now is kind of, you know, only coming from a handful of the really large players in the space that can cater to them?
Yeah, well, let's use that as a transition to go to another topic that's a huge, huge challenge. And so the second theme that we wanted to cover is, how do these business models truly reach everyone. We've done a lot of research, and a lot of our models project that by 2030, up to 15 to 20 million Americans may need to require switching occupations and reskilling. And when we've dug in, we've seen that that impact on women could be 4x the impact that of to men. If you cut that by different minority groups, we see something between 2 to 3x the impact. And so, the track record hasn't been very good when you look at either higher ed, when you look at ed tech, of really reaching these populations. And so what I'd love to hear from the panelists is, how are you all really thinking about, scaling these models, and in particular, reaching the populations that we haven't had a great track record reaching? And maybe Ardeen, do you want to kick us off?
So this absolutely is key. If you look, we've seen, we had the, maybe one of the benefits, if there is a benefit of the dark year and a half we've just come through, is entire industries were turned on their head overnight. And the volume of people who were impacted, just jobs went away. And it gave people a chance to sit back and say, how do I want to spend my time? Is the industry I'm in resilient? What do I need to do? And what we've looked at is, what can we do to help remove friction for adult learners? So our middle skill workers, the folks that make sure that the things that you order end up in the box and on your doorstep, have jobs. They have family obligations, and they're not going to quit and go back to school full time to get a degree in a STEM field. And so doing the work to say, what are those in-demand jobs in the local community? Who are the providers that can provide those skills? And then doing as much as we can to bring that training on site or make it shift convenient, so that those employees who are very representative of the population have access and are still able to keep good jobs that have benefits and pay. And so it really is about removing friction and helping to do some of the sorting, if you will, and say, hey, these are the good jobs that are available in the community that you're in, and here are the programs that'll help you get there, and then helping to provide some of the wraparound to get people moved into those spots.
Anybody else want to jump in on that one?
Yeah, it's a couple different thoughts here. One is, if you look at the data, like you mentioned, it's been incredible to see the decrease in labor force participation across the board. But when you disaggregate that, you can look at Black and Latinx workers. They represent about 30% of the U.S. workforce. They represent something like 44% of the decrease in participation. So you've got a group of people who have been hit far harder than the population at large. So I think that's sort of question or problem number one. When you get into it, something TJ mentioned earlier of, hey, as an employee, I want to make more money. And I think that's true to a large extent. One of the areas that I think that employers can help is by doing what Ardeen mentioned, drawing a really distinct path between what are some of the professional outcomes that you want. I want to work on different projects. I want to maybe make more money. I want to go into management. I want a new kind of job. I don't even know what it might be. A lot of people, it doesn't matter what your background or what your skill level is, a lot of people have trouble connecting the dots between their goals and what should I do, what should I learn? And so I think the companies that are finding the most success are the ones who are able to draw those very direct connections between here are the skills, competencies, attitudes that are required for certain roles into what are some programs that you can engage in, given your timetable, that will allow them to actually extend those skills. And I think the other part is employee resource groups can be a huge help here. I think we've seen a lot of innovation around cohort-based learning, and I think there's something to a combination of how employee resource groups can start to use some of the tactics that we've seen in cohort-based learning to help improve the group as a whole.
Maybe I'll go to you, Pierre, because you have done a lot of innovation in terms of support services, mentoring, things that people didn't necessarily find scalable and have found ways to do that. And I'd love you to talk about how you've ensured that that's a part of your day-to-day model and how that's helping reach populations that you may have not been able to do if you hadn't added those layers.
Yeah, first of all, as a mission-driven company, we wanted to make sure we were truly intentional towards underserved populations. And we defined that as job seekers, refugees, individuals with disabilities, school dropouts, and people living in underprivileged areas. So to do that, you need to first build a specific product with additional services. For example, we provide one-on-one mentorship every week on a 12-month-long program. So that means you're going to meet your mentors 50 times. For school dropouts, we double that. So they would see a mentor 100 times in the duration of the program. So it's really heavy and on paper, not scalable, although there are ways to make it scalable with a network of mentors and whatnot. But you need to be intentional towards those populations, and it could be actually a huge market opportunity to do so, because companies want to increase the diversity, inclusiveness of their workforce. So if you can provide a cohort of software engineers like any other bootcamp company, for example, it might not be so interesting, but if you can say specifically, I can provide a cohort of highly qualified software engineers who are women or people of color or something else, it could become very compelling for a company, for an employer, and highly differentiated on the market. So I think the combination of fulfilling those employers' needs towards more diversity, more inclusiveness, and also bringing back those populations and those individuals into the job market is really compelling. Actually, we just started a new program for returning mothers in Japan. That is quite interesting. We select women who left the workforce because of maternity leave, and then we train them on kind of an MBA-like program to bring tomorrow skills, tech, and leadership skills, and then with a headhunting partner, we go and try to find them a new job with kind of an upgraded skill set so they can really catch up on their male fellows. So those are interesting products that really serve a purpose, and yet at the same time have a huge market opportunity.
So I want to push on that thought a little bit, and given we've got a ton of entrepreneurs in the room, I'd love for this group, you know, if you were giving advice to an entrepreneur who wants to work on some of the challenges that Darren was articulating around the fact that, you know, if you look at any of the things that we're talking about, you have disproportionate impacts for Black and Latinx workers, and particularly due to COVID, there's such a differentiated impact to women. And so if you think about kind of the near-term challenge that many companies are facing, in your minds, what are some interesting business models or things that you'd encourage entrepreneurs to look into to try to support companies work on these challenges?
I can start since no one else wants to. That's a tough question. Well, I can tell you one of the things that we're doing to really try to attack like the deskless worker space or the blue collar worker, which I think kind of encompasses some of these groups. So if you think about a lot of technologies that are out in the market, right, they're not really designed to serve the blue collar worker per se. And so if you if you're able to reach that group, I think you can do a lot of good, because I think they're starving to get some technology in their hands to upskill themselves. And so, you know, I think with the invention of the smartphone and mobile technology, I think there's a lot of different things you can do if you try to serve that group and serve them really well. The problem is still there's a lot of companies out there that don't want to buy that technology, you know, for those groups, because they just see it as this added cost, and it might be a 10 or 20% engagement that you just utilize the technology. So at Degreed, we try to like really work with our clients that have big, you know, deskless worker groups, and we try to get really creative with them on how we can help serve those populations. There's also a lot of hourly concerns and all these other things around if they're on the technology, we have to pay them, but we just try to get really creative with them and try to really help them and connect them with other companies that have had a lot of success in that space, and typically a lot of good comes from that effort.
Other ideas? Go ahead, Darren.
One of the things I've seen a lot of success on, and Amazon has done a great job of this, is the creating and promoting certifications. So we know a lot of the knowledge worker jobs that people are trying to break into oftentimes bring with them requirements for undergraduate degrees that a lot of people in underrepresented groups don't have, and don't have the luxury of taking 2, 3, 4 years out of their life to go off and get them. And so the idea that we can create a different on-ramp into the skills economy that isn't just a 4-year degree through certifications, I think, is amazing. So I would highly encourage, if you work for a large company, the more you can promote your own certifications, business models that help employees kind of reach certification proficiency, I think are amazing, as well as creating your own certifications. So anything we can do to create that on-ramp, I think, will make this a better world and better industry.
I want to pick up on the better world piece. I think the other piece is looking further afield and saying, all right, what are some of the challenges that we see with those middle skill workers in terms of completion of upskilling? And in many cases, these are people who came through underserved schools. And are in need of remediation. Then this isn't news. This is the same challenge that we see in community college and in 4-year schools with first generation learners. And I think the opportunity is to say within the, Pierre rightly said, it's a very complex industry because it's state regulated. The accreditations are different for high school versus community college. So dual enrollment is hard. But what can you do to help those schools that are Title I or those students that came through underserved to help boost their skills and do remediation that doesn't make them feel discouraged and disenfranchised? Because if you can build up the skills, then they can be successful. And that's how we're going to start to grow the pipeline. And it's going to go back to, things like universal pre-K and what we're doing in the elementary years to ensure that all of our students have that foundation that they need to choose the path of career mobility that meets their interest rather than is limited by the background we've provided them.
Thanks. There's also definitely a party that's happening behind us, and so we'll try to wrap up in the next 7 minutes so everybody can get there. So the last thing that I want to cover, and this is now for the investors and the entrepreneurs in the room, is what I'll call buzzwords and predictions. And so what I want everybody to do is, as you start thinking about the next decade and, start looking into your crystal ball, what are some of the technologies? What are some of the new product features? What is the next generation of corporate learning and workforce development?
I can try and start. First, from an economical point of view, I'd say shifting from addressing the L&D budgets to more of a business imperative of first recruitment. So it can be through education's benefit programs, in which instead of just saying you're gonna pay for a training program and hope for the best, you're gonna actually improve business outcomes. But you need to demonstrate that as a training provider, and that's not that easy. You can also demonstrate a higher retention rate in terms of your workforce, and that could be really compelling in terms of ROI. So that would be one point. The other, I would say, would be skills assessment and skills mapping in an organization. So again, back to this question of massive upskilling and reskilling needs in many organizations or territories and geographies, when you truly ask those organizations or governments, okay, but who do you want to upskill and reskill, and on what and when? Nobody has any clue. So you actually need to start with mapping the current skills, defining the target skills of your organization, and then bridging this gap, and then you can train, upskill, and reskill those thousands of people. But so far, we've seen training providers at scale, a few of them, to be honest, not so many. But the link between training and skills mapping and bridging this gap is yet to be designed, I would say. It's really bubbling up.
Ardeen?
So I love that, but I want to do it faster and I want to do it at scale. And so what I want to be able to do is know for my employees what they need to know before they know. So how do I use natural language processing or AI to say, Darren's working on this new project. We have, you know, these all of these technologies. He needs these three to serve this client, and I can deliver that training in those bite size just in time. And I want to do it through an NLP, AI, some sort of my magic wand, because I don't want to have to map all of those things. I want it to do it itself. So that's my magic wand.
I would say the... I'll kind of pick up on the how do we close those skills? How do we close those skills gaps once we know what they are? If I zoom all the way back and look at what we've done as an industry in edtech, think about the different elements of learning. Like going back 2,500 years, if I'm going to get way too philosophical, bear with me, TJ. We're going to come back around. If I get way too philosophical, you know, we stood in the academy, we gave lectures, we talked to each other as a group, we learned from a mentor, we practiced. We as an industry, very rightly so, we picked the first element of that. We picked the lecture. We digitized it, we put it online, and we delivered it at scale. Right, so that's what Linda did with her model, that's what Aaron and Skills and Pluralsight did, that's what my old team at Udemy did with this amazing user-generated content model. And this is amazing. It's amazing to have this sort of reference library there. But if you think about what is the universe of how we learn and how we teach, we only digitize one component to it. So if I'm addressing the entrepreneurs and the investors, I would encourage you to think about how do we create scalable solutions that can recreate the other components of how we learn as human beings? So that once we go through the natural language processing, parsing, we're able to get to a learning outcome that actually matters.
Yeah, I'll just add that, you know, at Degree, we've been focused on trying to solve this challenge at scale of figuring out like what the skills are that people have and how to serve them the best so that they can upskill themselves. But when you do that and you do that successfully, it throws off an enormous amount of data. And so what we're trying to figure out as well is like, what do we do with all this data? And I think there's a lot of other platforms out there as well that are just collecting an enormous amount of data on a daily basis. But like, what do you actually do with it to drive those better business outcomes? So if you think about like what we're calling skills analytics, you know, it's like, what do you do once you have all this information, and how do you like serve that information out to your broader leadership teams? So they can have, they're armed with the right amount of information to make those decisions that they need to make on a daily basis. So if you think about sales, you know, before it was just looking at pipeline data and lead conversion and how long things were in the sales cycle, right? Instead, I want to be looking at like, how's this person's negotiation skills, right? How's their discovery skills? How's their relationship skills? Some of these soft things as well, that's really hard to like, to track on a dashboard. But if I was an executive that was over, you know, a company that had, say, you know, 30,000 salespeople, right, it'd be nice to have all that information all in bite-sized chunks about the individual, but also about broad teams, so I could figure out what to do with that.
That's great. So for the folks who are playing buzzword bingo, we got big data, we got AI, NLP, skills, cohort-based, you know, learning, analytics, but no VR and AR. So take that for whatever it's worth. The last thing, and we'll do, this will just be a rapid round for everyone. And so take 15 seconds to think about this question, and then we're going to hold you to this. But, you know, if you had to pick one institution, and it can't be yours, and feel free to pick any scale or startup, whatever you want, who's positioned to really win in this space?
We're all looking at Amazon right here.
So in the education space, I'm a big fan of Western Governor. I think that the all-you-can-eat model that's competency-based is very exciting.
I'll take a different spin on the question. It's like maybe a company that kind of fascinates me and I want to see what they're going to do is Guild Education. I think they've created a model that obviously works, and they've got a ton of revenue coming in from a small number of customers, but just wanting to see like if they can really kind of change the world with that.
Pierre or Darren?
Yeah, so I'll also change it a little bit. There's a company that fascinates me. It's called Workera, who's looking at how do we go deep down the road of assessments. And this is assessments have been like driving me crazy, keeping me up at night figuring out how do we do it. And of any company that I've ever spoken with, I think those folks in any discipline, which is around machine learning, AI, they seem closest to cracking the nut. And if I feel like if they can do it there, they or many of us can do it elsewhere.
And Pierre, last word.
Yeah, my first one would have been Guild, actually, which is one of our partners as well. Walker is pretty interesting. There is also SkyHive working on skills mapping. Skills assessment could be interesting to watch.
Well, great. Thank you all for punting that question. But this was a wonderful panel. And thanks, everyone, for listening in.
Thanks.